Hey guys, and welcome back to another episode of Eli's Kingdom. And yeah, it's really good to have you guys back. It's actually been a very couple exciting days for me here. It was just yesterday that I launched my YouTube channel. So for you guys, it may have been a couple weeks, or I guess if you're watching it from the future, it might have been you know, months, years. If you are watching it from the future, thanks very much, by the way. I hope you guys are enjoying it. And I guess if you're watching it today, then thank you as well. But no, it's been really exciting. I put up my first videos. I put up the teaser trailer for Eli's Kingdom. And if you haven't seen it, please do go watch it. I'm sure there'll be a link to it at the end of the video. But, you know, it was really good. It's gone down really well. I've had some amazing feedback from it. I got some really nice messages from various people just telling me how much they loved it. So it's put a huge smile on my face, and it's just made me want to record more and more episodes. So thank you very much for everyone who has watched that. But yeah, we've made it to episode 3. And the first thing I want to talk about, I think, is I need to tidy this area sometime fairly soon, because after what happened in the last episode, where we were over by the jewel spawner and we had that creeper incident exploding by our double chests, that's kind of scared me a little bit, because I have everything I own in these chests. You know, I've got my Fortune 3 pick, I've got my diamonds, I've got everything. And if a creeper was to explode here, I would probably lose this all, and it would make me really, really, really sad. And of course, it's probably quite easy to happen as well, because this is the access to my mineshaft. So, you know, I could just pop up here and there'd be creepers hiding around here. I need to be really careful. So I think what I'm going to do is, at some point fairly soon, this is going to have to be relocated elsewhere. Now, I did originally want to put this up in my sky base, which is going to be a series of floating islands. I'm now kind of thinking I might need to do some more work on the ground first, because obviously before we do the islands plan, we're going to need to gather quite a lot of resources for that, and I don't think that's going to happen anytime soon, because as you can see, this is all of the dirt I have. It's not very much. It's certainly not enough to build floating islands in the sky. So you know, we're going to have to do a lot more resource gathering for that, a lot more digging and things, and we need something pretty soon for the safety of these items. So I think what I'm going to do at some point in the next episode or two is I'm going to get some maps together and just kind of explore this area, kind of put it all down on a map, and that way I can get an aerial view of what this area looks like, and usually that makes it a little bit easier to plan how things are going to look, so I can, you know, really plan out where the bridge is going to go, and, you know, what can go in various places, and you know, maybe I'll have to start doing some more ground islands and have, you know, part of the base on the ground. Maybe the thing in the sky is just going to be a aesthetics. Maybe I'll move into it later on. I really don't know. You know, we're going to have to see how it goes over time and just basically figure it out as we go along. But this area definitely needs a tidy up. I kind of want to take out, to move some of these horses, because I feel really bad for them. They're just kind of constantly drowning away. And I don't know why they're all in the water. They seem to have made their way into the water and then got stuck. So I want to relocate them, because I do feel sorry for them. And then also something really weird has happened with all of my animals. I don't know why, but all of my cows and my sheep and some of my pigs have escaped. This thing was completely filled with animals. And they've just spilled out everywhere. So I'm not too sure why. The gates have been closed. Maybe there was too many animals in there and they somehow pushed out, but the gates were closed the whole time. I don't know why there's a bat over there. That's really odd. Yeah, okay. Maybe there's a cave down there. I don't know. But yeah, I'm going to have to, you know, re-sort this somehow. You know, make a better system where these guys can't escape. This is just a temporary area anyway. This, you know, I just needed to breed them up so I could get some leather for do my enchanting station. Of course, get some beef so I can have some food going around. I don't necessarily need sheep and pigs at this stage, but, you know, you never know when you're going to need them. So it was very handy to have them. But I think that's going to have to be relocated at some point. And then obviously just this area in general needs a bit of a tidy. There's this one spruce tree off in the distance, which I see every time I come over here, and it kind of annoys me, because you have this really nice looking forest and then just spruce all the way over there. So I want to go relocate that, and I probably put that up on this mountain. I planted a couple more along here just to make it look a little bit prettier, and I think I'll probably at some point make my way up here and try and get rid of some of these little kind of floating blocks, because I don't really want them there. You know, it's, yes, I want to defy physics with some islands, but at the same time, this is just, it's not needed. So I don't need to do that. I have done a little bit of work in the Nether. So if we just pop in here, it may be a little bit laggy for a couple seconds because I don't know if this is my computer or if it's the latest version of Minecraft, but it seems to lag out quite a lot when I come in. What I've done is I've just put a few of the kind of basic portals in place to various areas. So as you can see, this is the one that should take us to the Quad Witch Huts. There isn't actually Quad Witch Huts there, it's just right between, well, sorry, there is Quad Witch Huts, but there's no Witch Hut farms. That's going to be done at some point in the future, if I do get around to it. And then, you know, I have a few others here. I've got my portal to the mesa all the way down there. I've got desert for if I want to get sand. And one really cool thing I did find was I was just doing some basic resource gathering, and I think I came down here to get some quartz. So I was basically just traveling in one direction, and I came along here and I noticed this, which seems to be the first Nether fortress that we found, and it's not too far away. I mean, it could be a little bit closer, but it was a good find quite early on anyway. So what I did was I tunneled all the way down on this side. I had to build a bridge to get across, and I just basically cleared it out, went and got all of the items I could find from the chest. So I found a couple diamonds, I got some of the horse armor, and just kind of completely cleared it, got what I could from it. And what I did find was at the very back, they have these crossroads, and the crossroads are the places where the wither skeletons tend to spawn over quite a large area. And they actually have three of the crossroads in a row, so that should make for a very nice wither skeleton farm, which I probably will do in the next episode or two, because I'm going to need some beacons, and to do beacons, obviously, you need the wither skeleton skulls. I'm going to have to do that fairly soon, because obviously with the beacons, we can do a lot more mining, we can get a lot more dirt, a lot more stone. It's going to make everything much faster. So that's definitely a priority to do very, very soon. But I think for today's episode, I definitely want to start off with finishing off what we were doing in the last episode, which was just getting everything done with the jewel spawner. So I did actually put a little bit of a teaser to what I did off camera. I don't know if you guys noticed it, but in the thumbnail for episode 2, I actually came back the day after I finished recording, and I did a little bit more decorating while I was editing the video. Put a few kind of vines in place and a few leaves just to make it look a little bit more kind of overgrown and aged. And you can actually see that in the thumbnail. So if any kind of clever viewers spotted that, well done to you. Here we go. This is what it looks like. So I've just gone in, put a few cobwebs in, and it's a little bit too overgrown. So I did actually bring some string with me, because I think what I wanted to do was take some of these vines out and do the string trick where you place this in and then they obviously can't grow in any further. I changed the floor up a little bit. So the floor, I think I took out all the stone and I just put a little bit more detail. I realized why I don't like the gravel texture, and the gravel actually looks really good without a texture pack, and this is the faithful texture, and I think they've kind of messed up gravel a bit, because it's just not a very attractive block. It stands out pretty badly, whereas the original was very similar to andesite. You know, it was quite a subtle block, nothing like this, because this to me looks very similar to cobblestone, which I actually don't really like in faithful as well. I feel like cobblestone's a bit too detailed as well, but I guess that's the price you pay for using texture packs, is you have to some of them's going to work. I could actually take them out of the texture pack, but I'm going to leave that for now, and yeah, put some leaves in place. And of course we have the storage area, which I put in. I've gone and used a red stain clay behind, and I actually kind of like it. I know it's very contemporary, and I know that kind of goes against this kind of old rustic abandoned cave look, but I think it's going to go pretty well. You know, it's more of a converted cave, if you want to call that, where someone's come in and they've modernized it a little bit, and put some stuff in place to get it all working with this spawner. So yep, that was what I did off camera. Part of the reason I used the red stain clay was because it's going to have this really nice red glow to it with the redstone torches. This is going to be the only lighting that's going to shine through, because obviously we're going to keep this area really dark. When all these lamps are turned off, it's going to look quite eerie. This should give a really nice reddish orange glow coming through, so I'm quite happy with this. I think it's going to look amazing with obviously all these gaps going through. And then to put the items up here, I've gone and just kind of built the standard overflow protection sorting system. So these are the ones where you put in your items. At the moment, I've just thrown in bones here. These obviously need to be non-stackable items here, but I didn't have any on me, so I've just put in these for now. But yeah, this goes to 41, and when it's 41, you get a signal length of 3, which means it should never cross over into the other side. I haven't done anything with the other ones yet, but I'll need to work out exactly what's going to go in there. And then at the very bottom, we have our hoppers, which our items are going to go into. And I've decided to go for a dropper elevator to move these items up. Now, I kind of had 3 choices that I could have done. One was the dropper elevator, which I've obviously gone for. The other was the kind of traditional item elevator, which was broken in Minecraft 1.9. But then some very clever people came up with new methods of doing that. I haven't actually built one of those yet, and I really do want to. The third option was using minecarts, and I did actually really want to do minecarts. I thought that would look amazing. However, I decided not to do it because whenever I do minecarts, I kind of hate hearing the minecarts when I can't see them, and I thought it would have looked really cool if I'd actually left a gap where I could have a minecart that, you know, runs back and forth and it transports items from these hoppers into these chests. But of course, when I designed this, I didn't think about that. I didn't leave any gaps in. I could redesign this, but I like the way it looks. I'm not going to touch it now, but I would prefer to do that. I think it looks amazing, but no, I've gone in with the dropper elevator approach. And there's actually one more reason I did the dropper elevators, and that's because it uses redstone torches to power them. And the redstone torches, actually, when the items pass from the bottom to the top of the dropper elevator, the redstone torches actually flash in an upwards pattern. And I thought that might create a really cool lighting effect as well coming through here, so we should see some flashing lights when we're on this side. So I'm hoping that's going to look really good. I think what I wanted to do now was I actually wanted to build the dropper elevator on camera, so I'll need to go grab some resources for that, but I think it'll be a fun little project to do. It's a really simple build. If you haven't seen it before, we can go through and certainly build that, but I'm going to have to go back to the base camp and gather some torches, and I think I need some repeaters, I need comparators, just all the basics. Hopefully I can get back without too many mobs in the way. It doesn't look too bad, yeah. So I'll go gather those resources and then we'll build it. Okay, so if you haven't seen how to build these dropper elevators, they're pretty simple. You just start with a block coming out of just beneath your first dropper. So you have a comparator coming out of that. This comparator goes into a block with a redstone torch, and then place another block which is 2 beneath that, and then a piece of redstone dust on that. Another block there, which we're gonna have a repeater on, so this repeater powers this block, and then a redstone torch, which should power this very bottom dropper. And then from there, we just need to basically pillar up and power this. So if I just start coming up here, do one block on that, so that redstone torch powers this block. From there, we put a torch on this side, and we just repeat this pattern pretty much all the way to the top of our system. And then whenever we have a block which is on this side of the droppers, we actually need to put 2 torches on either side. So this torch on the left hand side basically translates the circuit upwards, and then the one on the right hand side is going to be for these droppers. So they're pretty fast and simple to build, which is why I like them. I know like droppers are considered old school and a lot of people love doing the, you know, the other item elevators, but these are really kind of resource light and they're just very fast and easy to build. They're always going to work, so you know, it's very unlikely that I didn't mean to fall down. It's very unlikely that they're going to stop working because they've existed in Minecraft for a long, long time, and I actually rarely see them being built in videos, which is quite surprising because they are really handy to do. So just need to give myself a little bit more space here, take out some of these blocks, And yep, you have to take them all the way to the very top. So I'm going to have to do one more here with a block there. And if it's like this, where this is level with your dropper, then you do actually have to take it slightly higher. So if I just place one more block here, and then we just need one torch. We don't need to do one on the other side. This one should power that dropper as well. This dropper goes into a hopper, which completes this circuit. And then if I make my way back down, take out these, because I don't need them. I think I should have some hoppers. Yes, I do. So I can actually go ahead and complete this circuit. I haven't really left myself with much room. By the way, these are the circuits for some of the lights that I've put in, which I'll just show in a second. So these droppers actually come along. I've not left myself with much room here, so let's see if I can do this. That goes in there, and then two more in there. That should be it. So, yep, we've got that firing, which is pretty good. That must be items passing through. Seems to be working. You can see the light circuit passing up, which is really nice. So that tells me everything's working. That's passing our items all the way to the top. And hopefully that's going to give a little bit of a glow coming through. I don't know how it's going to look. I don't know if it's going to make any impact at all, but kind of excited to find out. It's really nice to see items going through already. I don't know where they're going to head. It's probably going to be in this one because I've not put any sorting system in for that. To show you guys the lights, actually, which I think I forgot to do before, is I have installed a couple more redstone lamps in the bottom of these rooms because I was having this problem where, because this wall, it's only one block thick, I couldn't actually fit any torches in that wall, and I was getting mobs spawning on the inside. So I had to place these lamps in. I think they work. They may not be 100% efficient, but... Oh, I don't know why these ones are turned off. They should be on. I think we're going to have to go try and fix that. But yeah, they do seem to work. I have noticed... I mean, you can see there they're spawning with these off, and I think it seems to work. I mean, we don't have any zombies there, which is good, because we were just behind, doing the work behind here, so we would have had zombies come in. Let me just go see if I can figure out why those lamps are broken. I thought I'd wired it up all correctly, so I'm a bit puzzled. I think it's this circuit here, which, this is how these are powered, so these just got redstone dots in between these, and then these torches power those. I think it is... Can I do this without... Yes, I can. Okay, that's why. So obviously this circuit isn't long enough to power these. Yep, so I think we just need to throw in a repeater. Yeah, I've done one for that circuit. I've obviously forgotten to do one. So if we take out this and put that in, that should hopefully lengthen that circuit. Just go take a look and see how that looks. Then, yeah, that's worked now, so that's definitely handy. And I think the other thing which I noticed, which I'm going to have to fix, is something seems to be wrong with this. Oh no, it's working again. Yeah, it must just be because it was completely full. I thought that the hopper wasn't working, but no, it is working, so that's good. So, yep, that seems to be all in place. We have our items that get passed down through these trapdoors into our soul sand. There are hopper minecarts hidden in the soul sand. They pass it further down into those hoppers, which gets translated up that dropper elevator. And then I'll need to figure out what items are going to go in these various chests. So let's see what we have. We have skeletons, so we have bones, we have arrows, we have zombies, so we got zombie flesh. So we definitely gonna have our bones. Should probably do one for arrows, although I tend to never really keep the arrows. I don't really use them because when I do get a bow, it's gonna have infinity enchanted on it, so I don't really need that many. But I don't think there's that many other things. I mean, we do get bows, which I'm probably gonna discard. I'll have to do a lava pit somewhere where we can get rid of the items we don't need. But yeah, once that is done, I need to go do a little bit more tidying up, and I need to take out the lighting and see how this is going to look. I can probably do a little bit now just to see. It's a little bit dangerous doing this because obviously a creeper can spawn here at any time, so I'm a little bit hesitant to... If I just block this and block this, I think I probably need a bit more up here. Let's see how this is gonna look. Ah, I've got that in the way. Anyway, yeah, that's gonna need a bit of work, but you can see how this has got a little bit of a red glow coming from it. I think it's a red glow, but we're gonna have to see how that is. So I'll do a little bit more tidying off camera and see how this looks in a second. Okay, so that is the back tidied up, and as you can see, it's not quite as exciting as I thought it would be. We do have a little bit of a flashing light up in this top corner. There is a little bit of a red glow coming through, but that could actually just be the red stained clay. So I don't know, I may have to revisit this later and make this a little bit more exciting. I did put a couple redstone torches in the ground just to give a bit more light, but it's not as good as I thought it would be. Might be better with shaders on. I don't know. I might try that later on. But I think I'm going to leave it for now because it's not too important. But I do want to point out just how nice this ceiling looks. This looks incredible. I'm really happy with this. It was a bit of a fluke that it came out like this. But I'm so pleased. It's, you know, it looks like this natural light is just seeping through gaps in the rocks. So really happy with that. And I do want to move into the next part of today's episode, which is what I want to do behind this wall. And I have mentioned it. I think I mentioned it way back in episode 1 or 2. Basically, my plan is we have our 2 spawners here. So we have zombies on this side. Let me just put some lights on because I know that YouTube likes to make videos a little bit darker. We have zombies on the right hand side and we have skeletons on this side. So if we move through this wall to a certain point, then we should deactivate the zombie spawner, and we can also deactivate it with the lighting as well. We can definitely deactivate it by moving away. So what I wanted to do is have a little station in here where we had wolves, and the wolves should attack the skeletons. So I wanted to have some kind of switch or lever which changed this channel, so that rather than being channeled all the way up and dropped, what we can do is we can channel them in this direction and we can drop them down here, and then we can have the wolves attack them. And as the wolves attack, they should produce XP, which should fly along, and we can soak it up so we can be completely AFK, don't need to do anything. And because it's going to be an AFK spot, I also wanted to build a fish farm in this area. So we're going to do a little bit of mining, kind of dig ourselves a room, construct one of the fish farms. The fish farm is, I'll need to look up the name of who did it, I can't remember, I'll do that in the next clip. But it's a really good design, and you can AFK fish farm. It's a great way to get mending books. It's probably not as efficient as getting mending books from villagers, but it's certainly a handy way to start off with to do that. And of course you can get bows as well from fishing, so should certainly make a good starting point to get some items that we're going to need to get started. And yep, let's go ahead and do this. So I'm just going to spend a couple minutes mining this out, and hopefully it should look good when it's done. Okay, so that is most of the room dug out, and it's looking pretty good. I added this other viewing platform in so we could look into our skeleton spawner, and I thought it'd make a really nice touch. You know, we can see through into this area as well, and then obviously from this area we should be able to see our fish farm and our skeleton drop area. I had to move the lights up again, and it's definitely affected the spawner. As you can see, we're getting skeletons coming out with the lights on, so I think what I'm going to have to do is add in a few more lights there, and I think I'm even going to have to add in some lights in the ceiling, probably the same with the zombies, because we are getting one or two spawns, so that definitely needs a little bit of fixing. I haven't taken this room too far yet, because I'm not entirely sure how big it needs to be yet. I think this fish farm is around about 5x5 blocks. However, before I take this even further, I need to kind of plan what I'm going to do with here, because I obviously want everything to look quite symmetrical, but I'm not too sure how far this area is going to stick out, because I came to the conclusion that this is going to need a door in place for two reasons. Number one is we're going to have wolves in here, and the wolves are probably going to be kind of circled around our skeleton drop area. So that's going to be one of these blocks. I think the skeletons are going to fall out of the ceiling. They're going to land here, and our wolves should attack them. And then once they die, the XP orb should just roll across the floor to where we're standing. And we should be probably here. Fish farm will be in this direction, so we'll just be doing our fishing facing here and collecting all those XP orbs. But one of the big problems with this is obviously we don't want our wolves escaping and, you know, running to the skeletons over there in case we do have a couple that are just hanging out, as we already have. So we're going to need a door to stop that from happening. And then the other reason is because this is quite a large area now, when we're standing over here we could potentially get creepers spawning over by the entrance. So obviously that would be very, very bad if a creeper was to spawn and then make their way over here, explode while we're AFKing, and then presumably I'd come back to my computer and just find myself dead and probably lose all my chests in the process. So I don't want that to happen. I'm going to put in a door here, and I've decided it's going to be a piston door. Pretty much because I just love piston doors. They make me smile, so I think I'm going to do that here. It's going to be quite challenging, though, because this is actually a 3x3 area, and 3x3 piston doors, they tend to be quite bulky with the redstone. You know, it's going to come out 3 or 4 blocks, and I obviously don't want it to impose too much volume in this room, so I need to be a little bit clever with this. You know, I may actually shrink it to a 2x3 and, you know, see how that looks. I want to give this wall some depth as well. So I think I'm probably going to do another control panel similar to the one I've done over here, because I really like the look of this. You know, I think it's a really pretty control panel. So we're definitely going to have some controls to, you know, do something, open and close the door, or, you know, something with the lights. And yeah, the other thing I was thinking of is how are we going to open this from the other side, because, you know, we can have a lever up here, we can do a tripwire, we can do pressure plates. Probably not tripwire or pressure plates, because I think the main problem with that is the mobs can potentially open and close the door. I mean, I do love tripwires. I think they're pretty fun. Maybe I shouldn't worry too much about it. But yeah, if a creeper was to come along here, they could potentially open the door themselves. I guess we could have our control panel where we actually lock the door from the inside. That's definitely an option. So yeah, I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to pop into a redstone testing world, and I'm just going to play around with a few designs and see what I can come up with. Okay, so about an hour's passed, and I've come up with two designs that I'm really happy with. Here's the first. I built a replica of our dungeon, and this one's actually a hookless tripwire. So here in the ground, I have three pistons facing downwards with a string laid on top, which is our tripwire. And then as we walk over the tripwire, we trigger a block update, which opens the door. And then after a few seconds, the door should close behind us. It's a really nice, simple circuit. If I just go down and show you the redstone, this is our bud detector here. So if I just put a block there, we cause a block update, which fires the circuit. If you don't know how these work, they are really nice to learn. Basically, these pistons are currently in an unstable state. As you can see, these redstone torches are powering this block, so these pistons should be extended, but they're not. However, when we trigger the tripwire, it causes a block update, which extends these pistons, and that causes this circuit to fire, which retracts the pistons, and then a few moments later, these pistons actually extend, and once these torches are turned back on, these pistons want to try and extend, but they can't because these pistons are extended. So that's what causes it to be an unstable state, and that's why this whole system works. And then obviously when the circuit fires, we can take an output from that signal. We have to put it into a pulse extender so we can keep our door open for a little while longer. And it's a really nice, simple circuit. I really like this design. The only problem I have is I had to push this door back by one block. So obviously when we come through here, it does take up a little bit of extra room in this room, in this area. It comes up by about two or three blocks. And then being a tripwire, mobs can obviously activate it. So it might be a little bit unsafe. We could implement a lock in place, but that's kind of one extra lever that I don't really want to deal with it. So I have come up with a second design, which I think I'm leaning towards. This is a really nice, simple design. As you can see, I've not had to take this out any further. There's no tripwires. There's no pressure plates. There's no levers or switches. This actually is another block update detector. However, to open it, we simply have to open this chest. And we open the chest, we go through the door, and then a few moments later, the door should close behind us. So it's a really nice, simple circuit that operates in the same manner. And here we have the control panel, which I wanted to build. So the lever on the left is actually our way of opening the door from the inside. And this should leave the door open for, leave the door open indefinitely so we can move back and forth, which is something I really wanted to do because obviously you don't want to have to deal with opening and closing all the time. It's nice to have a mechanism just to leave it open. The middle lever here is actually for our maintenance hatch. I don't know if you remember it, but we had a maintenance hatch right here to gain access to our sorting system. So when we flick this, we get this open, and this should give us access to behind everything, behind the scenes, and we should be able to get to this redstone as well if we need to do any maintenance for this. And then the third lever isn't actually wired up yet, but that should redirect our skeletons. So it'll probably move some pistons, change the water streams. Instead of the skeletons dropping in the old area, what they're going to do is they're going to be channeled into this room here, and then they'll should drop through the roof into the central block, which will be lined up with this middle piston, and then they're there for our wolves to kill. So if we just go take a look at the redstone for this, I managed to get it pretty compact, so it's a nice simple circuit. It operates by the same principle, so this is the chest that we open, and then diagonally from this we have our pistons. So when we open this chest, we cause a block update, which has the same circuit, and then from that we take a signal from this. One thing to point out is if you do want to build one of these circuits, I noticed that if you put this into a pulse extender, it only seems to work when you have two comparators. If you try and stack these things up so you have any more, the pulse is so fast that this just doesn't work. So you have to actually separate these things. So you can have as many comparators as you want here, but you initially have to have two for this whole system to work. And then obviously we have our circuits here for the levers, which should just fire the pistons on the top and bottom. So it's a really nice, simple design. I do like this, and it takes up a much smaller footprint. So we only have, I think it's around about two blocks here. So what I think I'm going to do is I think we're going to go with this one because I do like it. I like the fact that it's a hidden switch as well. So only me and you guys know about this, and certainly none of the creepers, skeletons, or zombies know about this. So it should be a nice safe room to stay in. So I'm going to go ahead and build this one. And as if by magic, all of the redstone is complete. And it was fairly simple. I did have one or two problems that cropped up. The first being this circuit here for the lighting. I did have to move the circuit up slightly because it was somehow powering these pistons. Not too sure how, because it wasn't touching or anything. But it did have to move this up a little bit. The other problem I had, which was actually quite a serious problem, is the butt switch just didn't seem to work in this world. So I had to replace it with something even simpler. This is basically just a sticky piston and a redstone block, and I didn't even know you could do this, but it seemed to work. So you open this chest. This is the chest that we're going to have our thing hooked up to, and it just extends this, which fires up the circuit. Of course, this means that you no longer need this extra wire in the center, but I've just left this in because obviously we have a circuit coming in here. But it's a really simple design. I kind of wish I'd done this to start with. And then, yep, the other thing I've done here is I've started digging into our channel where our skeletons come. So I'm not too sure exactly how I'm going to do this, but I'm going to have some pistons kind of push out, and it's going to redirect this channel into our main room, or just above our main room, I should say. And once that happens, then they're going to fall through the roof and drop. I've just put a block down here to kind of show where it's going to be. I might actually put another little channel here so we can see them move up, because I do like the one over there. You know, it's nice to see that everything's working properly, and then, you know, maybe we can have them drop further down in the center. But yeah, this door I really like. It takes up such a small profile in the room, so I'm really happy with this. I did actually notice that when this thing is closed, this door actually looks like a natural pillar in the room, so I think I might actually just replicate this on. I could potentially do it on all four corners, just so it looks like it's part of the room, and I guess we could have a secret door on other sides, or maybe not, but you know, we can certainly do something cool with that. So I think I've got some good ideas for what I'm going to do with this room, but unfortunately that is all we have time for today. So thank you very much for watching, guys. If you've enjoyed this video, then please do leave a like. If you want to keep up with my latest episodes and all my tutorials, then please do subscribe. I've been Eli. Thanks for watching.